my prayer let come before you. If you kept record of my sin and held against me what I've been, how could I stand before you?
Sends redemption through his word. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, he has removed your guilt forever. You are his own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to his will. Amen. Peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, fellow children of God. The second scripture reading, which is the basis for our meditation this morning, at first might seem a little out of place with the other two readings. So when we turn to the Old Testament reading, we see how God displayed his power through the prophet Elijah. There was a family who had spent some time and effort providing for God's prophet. They had even built an extra room onto their home so that Elijah could stay there when he was traveling through. And when their son died unexpectedly, they turned to Elijah. They turned to God's prophet. And in turn, God, through Elijah, brought this son back to life. He showed his power and his grace. And in turn, they understood that what Elijah proclaimed wasn't just what Elijah proclaimed, but it was what God proclaimed through Elijah. As the woman said, "Now I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord from your mouth is the truth." And then our gospel lesson tells a similar story. This time it's Jesus who displays his own power as the Son of God. He's coming into a city called Nain, and there's a woman there who lost her only son. She was a widow, so she lost the only one who was going to be able to provide for her. And it's very clear that there was a close connection between this woman and her son. And when Jesus saw what had happened, even before she asked him for help, he reached out and he brought this son back to life. And once again, that display of God's power caused an effect. The people understood that this is someone they needed to listen to. As we read in our gospel lesson, they were all filled with awe and praise God. "A great prophet has appeared among us," they said. "God has come to help his people." Miracle helped people realize that the message Jesus proclaimed must be the truth. And now when we turn to the second lesson, we don't find a widow or a widow's son. We don't find anyone who physically died. But at the same time, as we look at this second lesson, we also realize there was someone who had died. Someone who was spiritually dead. Saul, or as he later would be known, Paul, had been separated spiritually from his father in heaven. And just as God displayed his power in bringing people back to life, it would be by God's power alone that Saul would be brought from spiritual death to spiritual life. And so also, as we look at this lesson for this morning, we turn that same gospel has the same power, the same effect in our world and in our lives today. And so we can trust in the gospel. We can trust in this gospel because it comes from the Lord himself. And we can trust in the gospel because it gives the gift of new life. Paul offers this proof in the opening chapter of his letter to the Galatians. There he writes, "I want you to know, brothers, that the gospel I preach is not something that man made up. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my previous way of life in Judaism, how intensely I persecuted the Church of God and tried to destroy it. I was advancing in Judaism beyond many Jews my own age and was extremely zealous for the traditions of my fathers. But when God, who set me apart from birth and called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his Son to me so that I might preach him among the Gentiles, I did not consult any man. Nor did I go up to Jerusalem to see those who were apostles before I was. But I went immediately into Arabia and later returned to Damascus. Then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to get acquainted with Peter and stayed with him 15 days. I saw none of the other apostles, only James, the Lord's brother. And so I assure you before God that what I am writing to you is no lie. Later, I went to Syria and Cilicia. I was personally unknown to the churches of Judea that are in Christ. They only heard this report. The man who formerly persecuted us is now preaching the faith he once tried to destroy, and they praise God because of me. This is the word of our Lord. Now, the reason that Paul starts his letter to the church in Galatia, this way, is there were some who were trying to discredit his ministry. Namely the Judaizers. And if you remember, the Judaizers were people who, on the one hand, they wanted to be known as followers of Jesus, but on the other hand, they had a hard time giving up the Old Testament rules and regulations, and especially had a hard time giving up the traditions that were handed down from generation to generation. And so when they heard Paul proclaiming that message of free grace by God, the message that you didn't need to follow any of the laws, all you needed to do was trust in God, as Paul would also later write in his letter to the Romans, and if by grace, then it is no longer by works. If it were, grace would no longer be grace. When they heard Paul proclaiming that message didn't really sit well with them, because they wanted to look at what they could do, what they could offer to the Lord. And so they tried to discredit Paul's message. And one way that they tried to do it is say, well, you can't listen to anything that guy says because he wasn't even one of the original disciples. He wasn't one of those 12 people who were walking around with Jesus during his ministry. And, you know, to a certain extent, they had a point. Paul wasn't in the crowds that gathered around to hear Jesus and hear him preach the Sermon on the Mount or the other times. And Paul wasn't there the day when Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper. In fact, if Paul had been there when Jesus had been arrested, very likely, without a doubt, Paul would have been very supportive of the Sanhedrin's decision to get rid of this troublemaker altogether. In fact, Paul admits that he had tried to destroy that message of Jesus Christ. Now, the Judaizers tried to use that as a reason to discredit Paul, but Paul, on the other hand, said, you know, that's only more proof that what has happened in my life has happened by God's power and grace. Because it doesn't make sense that Paul, who was such a zealous Pharisee, it doesn't make sense that Paul, who himself admitted, I was advancing in Judaism beyond many Jews of my own age and was extremely zealous for the tradition of my fathers. It doesn't make sense that with all that opposition that he had displayed in his life on his own, he would now be following the one who claimed to be the king of the Jews. There was no human argument that could have changed Paul's mind. Instead, that very fact that Jesus is the one who changed him from Saul, the persecutor of the Christian church, to Paul, the first missionary in the Christian church, is evidence of God's work and God's power in his life. And so it's very clear that it's only by God's power that this change was made. And it was only by a miracle of God that Paul's heart was changed. And that's exactly what happened. In the book of Acts, we read about how Paul was on his way to a town called Damascus, and his whole purpose of going to that town was to arrest and persecute more of these people who were called Christians. But while he was on the way, God did something incredible. A bright light flashed before him. Paul fell to the ground and he heard Jesus say, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute? Jesus is the one who changed his heart. Jesus is the one who brought Paul from spiritual death to spiritual life. And so then Paul takes the next step, because Jesus was the one who changed Paul's heart, who commissioned him to be that missionary in the Christian church. It was also Jesus who gave him the message that he would proclaim. Now, we don't know how much of that message Paul received that very day when God changed his heart. We don't know how much he received a little later by divine revelation, how much he received from the Holy Spirit when the Holy Spirit led Paul to see the promises of God being fulfilled in Jesus. But that message certainly came through God alone. And because that message didn't come from any person, any human being, Paul didn't go back to the other 12 disciples and check and make sure he had it right, or make sure that, you know, the message had changed in any way between the time they received it and he received it. No, he trusted that because it came from God, it was the sure, true foundation of the Word. And Paul writes about how he went up to Jerusalem, but the point he's making is the only reason he went up to Jerusalem, he wasn't there to learn, because God had already given him the message. He was simply there to meet his fellow believer, his fellow evangelist, Peter. And odds are the reason that he didn't meet many of the other apostles was because they were out proclaiming that message that he himself was proclaiming. And the whole point is that because Jesus is the one who gave Paul this new life, because Jesus is the one who commissioned Paul to his work, Jesus is also the one who gave him the words to proclaim and the words that he wrote. And that's where this lesson really has a lot of importance for us, because God used the Apostle Paul to write a pretty good-sized chunk of the New Testament. And we can be sure that those words aren't just words that people made up, but they're the words that came from God himself. And that's important because a lot of times people, you know, dismiss the Bible as, well, that's just one group's thoughts. That's just one group's philosophy. How many times do people describe the Bible as just one option? One option out of many different roads that all lead to the same God, or lead to heaven. Or for that matter, how many times do people try to pit something that Jesus said over against something that Paul wrote in one of his letters, as though they're not on the same page? How many times might we be tempted to maybe, well, we have to tweak this passage just a little bit so it's not so abrasive, not so confrontational in a world of getting along today? And perhaps one of the reasons that our human nature and many people are tempted to change God's word a little bit is because it doesn't really seem fair. Think of the Old Testament Judaizers. They had a hard time giving up the idea that they needed to contribute at least a little bit, whether it be sacrifices or circumcision or one of the other Old Testament rules and regulations. And in much the same way, our human nature does the same thing. There has to be something that I can do. There has to be something that I can add. There has to be some credit that I can receive for my salvation. And that's why Paul talks about that message of Jesus not seeming fair. In fact, sometimes to people seems downright foolish, as he writes his letter to the Corinthians. We preach Christ crucified, which is a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. And yet, even though God's word might not always make sense to our human nature, even though God's word might not fulfill that desire we have oftentimes to take some credit for ourselves, God's word and that message of free and faithful grace always remains God's word. Peter explains that much when he writes in his second letter, "Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation, for prophecy never had its origin in the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit." Paul wasn't ashamed to proclaim the gospel because it wasn't his message. He was simply a herald. And in much the same way, we don't want to change God's word, but simply proclaim the truth because we know it is the good news about Jesus and all that he has accomplished for us. And that is so important because it's only through that good news that we have the peace and comfort of knowing that we can be a part of God's kingdom. And here again, when we think of Paul, that's something that he experienced in his own life. He was raised as a strict Pharisee, and so much of his focus was on what he could do and what he could offer God and the rules that he could keep and the traditions that he could follow. He was so zealous about keeping all those traditions that he was even ready and willing to persecute the church. He writes in his letter to Timothy, "I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man." And yet, even his strongest efforts couldn't give him the peace of knowing that he was reconciled to God. Instead, the only thing that could break down that barrier of sin and give Paul the comfort of knowing that he could be reconciled to God was that message of Christ. It's only through the fact that Jesus was willing to live and die for Paul and be raised again that Paul could know that all of his sin and guilt could be taken away. That's why later when he was thinking about his good works, those works which were so important to him at one time in his life, after Jesus had revealed his grace to him, he had a whole different attitude. He writes, "What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in him." It was through the gospel message and that message alone that God made this incredible change in Paul's life so that he could have this new life in service to God's kingdom. And in reality, that's the same thing God does for us. He changes our hearts. He changes us from enemies into a part of his family. Now, we might say, well, I never went around persecuting the Church of Christ, and I doubt there's any of us who went from town to town trying to get Christians arrested. But at the same time, every time that we fail to keep up his commands and break one of his laws, we reveal ourselves to be enemies of Jesus. Every time that we try to claim credit for our place in God's family at all, we're trying to take glory away from Jesus. That's why Paul also writes in Romans, "The sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so." On our own, we would always have that separation from our God. And yet, through the message of Christ, God is the one who changes our hearts. God is the one who brings us from spiritual death to life. And most often he doesn't do it by a big flash of light and some words that are spoken from the sky like he did with the Apostle Paul. Instead, most often the way the Lord calls us to be a part of his family is through the gentle whisper of the gospel. It's through the water that's poured over our head, connected with the promises that are found in God's word. It's through that message that we hear every time that we open up scripture that tells us that even though we are miserable sinners, God loved us enough to send his son to shed his blood so that our sin and guilt could be taken away once and for all. It's through that message of the gospel that God makes a change in our life that was just as incredible, just as miraculous as what happened with Paul on the road to Damascus. And we give thanks to God for that. We give praise to his name because now we have the peace of knowing we are a part of his family. But not only that, when God calls us to be a part of his family, he also gives us the opportunity to serve him in his kingdom. And one of the ways we can do that is by taking that same unchanging message, by taking the Bible, which is not the word of people, the philosophy of men, but the word of God itself, and sharing that message with the world. And just as that message produced fruit in Paul's day, it produces fruit wherever it's proclaimed by the power of the Holy Spirit. And so may we put our trust in God's gospel. May we trust in it because it has given us the gift of new life, that it continues to stand as a foundation of our faith. Amen. Amen. Oh, may this grace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Patiently, the cross of grief or pain, leave to your God to order and provide. In every change, He faithful will remain. Be still, my soul, your best, your of tears, then you will better know His love, His heart, who comes to soothe your sorrows and your fears. Be still, my soul, your Jesus can repay from His away. soul, the hour is hastening on, when we shall be forever with the Lord. When disappointment, grief and fear are gone, sorrow forgot, love's purest joy is restored. Be still my soul, when change and tears are past, all safe and blessed we shall meet at last.